So I was working out here last night when one of my grinders fell fully into this big... Can you see how full this water is? It fell in there. It rolled off one of these things. Sploosh! I think that the bucket was over here or something. And I was like, oh! And I had to race to unplug the thing from my janky plug setup as fast as I could. And then I pulled the grinder out and I started stripping it apart and blowing it off with the... Is the blower in the end of the tube? No, the blower's not in the end of the tube anymore. But yeah, I blew all the parts dry-ish. The things that the dunk could have killed in the time it took me to take it apart and dry it off were mysterious things inside the switch and mysterious things inside the very mysterious speed control it has, which is a very fussy electronics gadget. The actual field and stuff, I'm not so worried about all of this guy because this was relatively easy to dry. Okay, here goes. Okay, perfect, it works. So now, these studs on the end of the power conduits, I don't know what you'd call them, they have a rounded end. So I'm gonna fill this guy up with weld and then take it down with my primitive lathe technology and add this copper thing in here because I'm hoping the copper will not fuse if any of the weld falls on here, because it doesn't like fusing steel, and also it'll stop random crap falling in the shaft. Ugh, gross. Gotta clean that up now. Thing here. You might want to have a look at. Is this pen not working? Here. God, MIG welding is so filthy compared to the TIG welding. That way I have the center of this guy. So as you can see, the circle was pretty close to this edge, but by calculation it should be okay. Okay. Look how much weld is in the top of it. Whoa. The annoying thing now, which I probably won't even film, is I have to make a number two of this guy. That's the second one. You can see it needs to be shaved down a little bit. Can you see that air gap there? So a little touch of the sander, and that's number two done. It's very annoying that I have two of these useless halves left that are slightly too small to use. But you know, whatever. So according to the template, which is increasingly getting more beaten up, the bevel is more than an inch. Looks like it's in slightly less than an inch and a quarter. And then it does that thing that a lot of fantasy blades do, where it gets near the top. But I'm just going to make it an inch. I usually go twice the material thickness for my bevels. I mentioned it in some previous video, and some knife people chimed in saying, yeah, that's fine. If I did this, like this up here at the top is practically two and an eighth. I'd just be worried that the very tip of it would start to get fragile. Like a lot of my things weigh so much more than regular blades. That you just have to be cognizant of the amount of momentum they generate whenever they hit anything. It's got an odd transition in here towards the back. Here, starts to do something towards here. You know, the curve. So we get out my other gadget, the little plate with the holes, and we try to remind ourselves which it's the last. So yeah, whoop. Ah! There we go. Probably been a while since I mentioned this, but this is for doing those curved bevels. Marking a curved line parallel. Just a pair of bolts that sit against the edge of a surface and a bunch of holes for different depths. So now how does this go? There's a parallel line here. This edges is a bit mysterious. And then these connect up like this, although what exactly that means is a little bit questionable. Ah, I messed it up. I'll have to redraw before we begin, because I'm going to start by sharpening the whole thing. I'm just going to bring this down. And then it probably means this one gets beveled more. I'll bring this one down to the middle. And then I guess this line is resolving the difference between. So that triangle is created by this. Here would be my guess. Now that's probably good enough for sandpaper. Now the part I like is checking for discoloration on the other side. Yow, yow, yow. I wonder, can this camera do it? It is such a manual focus. How much? This little yellow tinge here. There's something yellow here, but I'm not sure. Little yellow thing here. Yellow's okay, blue is the killer. Oh, this part is yellowy. Is that one little blue spot there? That's one little blue spot there. And then the tip, I can't quite tell, but I think we got away with just yellowy stuff near the tip. And where's the bluey? Oh, was it just dirt? Hang on. I think it might just be grinder dirt. Well, actually, this would sand off the blue as well, so this is kind of pointless. But yeah, when I was looking at it through not the viewfinder, that was just grinder dirt. This is just yellow on this side, so I think we managed to sharpen the whole thing without endangering whatever temper this hard ox has. So this is the little piece that goes on the back of the sword. The problem is, now that I put the engine block in the wrong place, the fat shark guy says, oh yeah, it doesn't matter, but I have to shorten this part before I stick it on. There was no need for this to be a separate part as well, which is the extra annoying thing. It should have been just part of the sword blank. I just wasn't thinking straight. So that goes on there like this. It should have been part of the blank. It shouldn't be a separate piece I'm welding on. Oh my god, the latent magnetism of the piece of hardox is just holding it on there. I'm not sure why hardox is very magnetic when it arrives, but it is. I've heard people say, oh, it's because they pick it up with big magnets, but if they pick hardox up with big magnets, they would have picked all the other steel up with big magnets, and the regular steel, when it arrives, is not this magnetic. So many claps in the way. Now to hit it with the belt sander. I wish I'd made this thing part of the blank. And so forth and so on. Gotta weld the other side now. So, now I have to clean up these bits. Gotta clean up this in here, but I think I'll move it around in the vise. These guys here have bevely things that match the, oh you can't see them, match the bevely things on the front of these. So, gotta draw those. Now that this block is in place, I want to think about getting these rods permanently locked down. What's the difference there? 5.5? Ugh, 5.5 doesn't divide by 3. What is it? 140 divided by 3 is 40 what? 47? 47 plus 47, 94. Where you got? There it is. Boop. Maybe it should be thirds of the whole length of it. It's 170. 170 div 3 is like 57. Does that look any better? A little bit. I think I'll go with that. And then these ones were just a guess. Actually, one last thing before locking these down into place. I'm a little bit worried that these guys will wind up hard to join on. If I weld through the flat part, it'll be easier. So I'm going to drill these and see how this interacts with what's below. Like I might have to wind up cutting these things back. It's too hot to actually touch. So at the very least, I'll have to cut off not that much, like this much of the copper bar, bronze bar. So I took measurements before, and this was 4.48 before. And that feels like it's fairly good in the groove. But let's just see. Ah, 4.4. That's fine. Take a measure of this guy here. Hopefully similar. 4.62. Do the same thing. Ah. So this one fits too, but it was a bit more of a tighter fit. This peg here, I think it's just a little bit this way. Like we're talking fractions of millimeters. But the thing I want to see is whether or not the distance between them stayed similar enough, or am I in trouble? So this should be something like 30, 31? 31. Maybe I got it wrong. Now, is this 31? 31.3. So I think we can live with 0.3 of a millimeter. Ha! That one measures 31.2 now. So we're talking about the accuracy of this janky thing. So, yeah, that's good enough. There's some mysterious crud on the steel wire brush that I wish wasn't there. It's oil or something. Ah, oh, gross. But I think I got it. Ugh, I'm gonna clean this guy off with acetone. Yeah, it's good. This guy. Get this one. What I'm trying to do is add enough material to bring it up above grade so that when I polish back, it'll be invisible. This is now part of that surface forever, hopefully. Now just a bunch of delicate cleanup to do. This is double-sided duct tape. I could buy a million different boxes of different grits of these sandpapery pads, but I don't wanna. It would appear the TIG braze is actually harder than the silicon bronze rods are slightly harder than the silicon bronze, which I wasn't expecting, but there you go. It's gonna be a little bit finicky to flatten this out. I wonder why this didn't show up on my sample piece. There's still some weird shadow here I don't like, but I don't think there's much I can do about it. Since it's a different level of hardness, apparently, if I try sanding it down, this stuff's so soft. Yeah, that's even more. Usually I'm like, oh, it's hard to see in the viewfinder, but it's even more obvious in the viewfinder. Blech. Oh, weird. Those kind of burnt sticky spots where I was doing the sanding on this. Using a blower and acetone is probably a bad idea. Okay, none of it sprayed in my eyes. That was the thing I was waiting for. And that's these bars locked down to the surface. Hopefully they'll tarnish out to a more copper color again. So, I'm not sure will this work, or is this a good idea, but I need to accurately position these guys so that I can weld them actually from the underside. And so I'm just gonna try a little bit of glue. Like, I don't like the glue because it's just more cleanup for me to do. But hopefully I'll be able to get these guys off and then clean off the glue. Salt water dissolves super glue, I think. So do this and then figure out some way to dissolve the super glue afterwards. Although I hate to put salt water on this thing after it's all polished up. So I'm gonna leave that to dry and then see does it work trying to take it off. Okay, so that's up now. Now if I can manage to clamp this into position without breaking those wells, we should be good. So the plan, such as it is, whoop, the super glued things, I heard a crack when I clamped this one down. And so the plan is now, if nothing has shifted or moved, there's a hole on the back of this plate, and I'm going to try and weld into the hole and join the thing on in the correct position from behind, and then unclamp it and see, was that all nonsense? Did it all go wrong? Okay, wow, that's the wood on the other side burning. Oh, and it might be the super, it's probably the super glue burning as well. So that's one of these tacked on, and now to do the other one. Whew. Now that these are welded, I have to clean up the welds a bit so that the... Oh man, I wish I had a thing with a longer stem so that things would actually fit in again. Now to see, does it actually fit on? Now when I put it on, I'm hoping it'll line up with these lines and the straight line. If it goes on at all. Oh, well that was painless. Is it actually flat? It's flat on the back. What about on this side? It's riding the littlest bit, the littlest bit high here. Can the camera capture this? Not really. There's just a little bit of, I can see air here. I might just give it the tiniest little tickle with the, sanding belt and see does it sit flatter on here. But that's nearly perfect. Okay, I got it nice and flat now, but what I had to do is just sand the littlest bit off these guys so they're making contact up here where they actually stick out, and that guy here is nice and flush and it can line up with the line at the back here. Whew, tricky. Now I can clean up these things. Now the last thing I have to do with this block and the sister block on the other side is drill holes through it for actually for the purposes of locking it down onto the surface. My plan is to weld this whole thing on and then put these blocks on afterwards. But I was just trying to work out where there's a lot going on this block. Like it has all these things going on here, and then there's the plate on top, and then there's where these things, these notches come in underneath. So through drawing all these lines, I think it'll be safe to drill the holes here and here, and then I'll just match them on this other block because the, you know, all the stuff, this one has less going on underneath because it doesn't have these things. So I think a half inch hole, and then I'll be able to lock it down to the surface by welding into the bottom of that. I think I might have to buy new belts for the drill. It seems to have lost torque at the slower speeds. I had to drill this much faster than I would like to, just so the drill bit could get grip on the hole for drilling. So the other thing I want to do, if this thing now, is I had to use loads of oil because of the high speed issue. People who watch my videos will know I'm not a big fan of the cutting oil, because then when you go to weld, especially if you're doing this kind of plate to plate nonsense, the oil will boil out any residual oil left. Like I tried cleaning it with acetone, but unless you're like hyper aggressive with soaking something in like brake clean or something, it's very easy to miss bits of oil. But anyway, will this guy draw on the surface or is it too oily? I was thinking it might look cool if this area underneath the grill was taken down a little bit. And because I'm then planning to color it black with something, doesn't really matter what, probably going to use the gun blue, but like the paint would work just as good. If I take this area down, make it look like a depression, it'll add to the 3D effect. Oh wow, there's one part that won't blacken. I wonder, is that oil? So something like that, and then if I can very carefully wipe off the parts that aren't the recess, it gives this kind of 3D effect that there's like a depth behind the plate kind of thing. You can see the edge of that hole I need to weld into here. Oh, and this one's kind of hiding because of the shadow, but that's the idea. Now, wipe this off. This will interfere with the weld. Ooh, can I wipe it off? Maybe I'm just going to have to live with a little bit of soot in there till I do the real thing. Steel wire brush will probably get it out. I should have added more sandpaper. So there's a socket down there now that hopefully the thing can line up with. So using super glue to initially line up things worked well for this block. So I'm going to try, and I used super glue on these guys to position them. And so my hope is, as I weld, it'll wind up in the right place. And I have the black line drawn to show in case it did wander a bit. So here we go. Wow, I can't imagine the glue held out for that. Oh, I can smell it though. Burning, melting super glue. The best smell. It may not have drifted too bad. It's just there's a lump on this side now that's pushing it out this way as I try to put it down. I might try to TIG braze it in here at the back. I have to clean that up enough that this guy can... Ooh! It still more or less goes on. It's just it's pushed out to one side because of the lumpiness, so I have to do a bit of delicate die grinding. Now I've got to do the same down here. How close is that to the edge? I have like half a millimeter. Yeah, that's flat now. Does this guy go on? It does. Does it line up with the line at the top? It does. Is it genuinely flat? It is. But that's the idea. Now I can weld that pin in. And this guy will be locked tight. I'm probably better off to clean this up properly before that. Clean it up. as both of those nodes are now. The saw very handily comes with a light, but the light assumes you're on the other side. So it actually, see that shadow? The shadow from the light gets in the way of what you're trying to cut. This part here is supposed to be a straight line, but I wasn't able to get that with this guy. So I'm going to have to file that out, but I was able to get the rest of it. Yeah, it's an awkward little shape that needs to be precise, so I decided to do it with this guy instead of the angle grinder, because lots of straight little cuts. So I want to do a practice fold to see, is this enterprise I'm about to engage in nonsense, or would it has any chance of working at all? Just by coinkadink, the tip of this chisel is about the same as the angle I need for this. I don't even know how I explained what I'm doing yet. So hopefully this wood is soft enough. Where's my big hammer? There it is. Let's see, will this work? I'm not seeing any fatigue on the steel yet, which is what I'm worried about. That is bending. It's not breaking yet. But it's got a hell of a long way to go. I thought this wood would be nice and soft. I wonder, this guy is the right angle already. Let me put this over. No fatigue on the steel yet. Way more to go angle-wise. Now we're having an issue with the back of it, this groove being the correct angle. I had to mutilate a different chisel to get it. And I don't even know, did I get it? Like, is this, like, shape the correct shape yet? Now to try and fold the second part of this. So as I was trying to bend it, this one was coming unbent, which is obvious enough. So it seems silly, but I'm going to weld a support in here to keep this angle the correct while I'm bending the other side. Hopefully that's enough to keep it behaved. Unfortunately, one of the things that I hadn't accounted for is, one, measuring up the relationship between this angle and these angles. So when these two are like this, this one also has to be in the middle of these two. And I can't think of any good way to measure that other than it fitting on the thing and looking right, which hopefully will be good enough. And also that when these two guys stand up, you can, like, if I tilt this guy so that this is 90 degrees, is this 90 degrees? It's pretty freaking close. There's a conflex shape around the top of the handle where there's this inverted hexagon type thing going all around. Trying to see around corners and stuff here. That's both of these guys welded in now, and now I have to bend these two angles closer together. Where's my cardboard template? I don't want to burn it. These two points here, they have to be bent like on the cardboard template to come closer together. Wow, I bent it too much. Have to ease it off a little bit, I think. Come on. Do what you think. Okay, that angle matches. Oh wait. Nearly made a mistake. Gotta clamp this guy on the other side. The cardboard one of these went astray. Oh, I tacked this in the wrong place. I can't quite make sure it's in the right. This bit here is in the way. Now, is this the right angle? More! Yeah, I think that's it. Yeah, that's it. Awkward. Okay, that's the shape. And that was just with the steel wire brush. I didn't have to put it in the vinegar bath overnight or nothing. That's like directly after the last clip. So I have to do the same to this piece of steel, and then hopefully I'll have the two halves. So this is both sides bent. This side matches pretty freaking closely, but this side, there's a little bit of a gap, so I'm hoping if I tack here, I can give this side a bit of a squish and get it more perfect. But I'm happy enough with this to proceed. So here we go, I guess. I'm just going to see, can I give that other side a bit of a squish? Oh my god! I dropped it into the water bucket. Yeah, that'll do. Now, do I want to squish this bottom bit too? I think it's necessary. Hang on. Whoa! Hot. Now, let's see, can we actually get that guy off there now? There we go. Will it go back in? No, it'll probably have to be brutalized in. not too bad though. Now I want to square off the top and bottom, flatten them. Although I'm not exactly sure how, what you square them to. There's not a proper angle anywhere on this thing to measure from. Okay, that's that side flattened off, hopefully. And now I can just check the height. But my guess is it's going to be pretty good. Mostly worked, other than some little bits down here. It's very hard to tell the surface texture of this part is different to the sides, ones either side. Just cooking the surface. Can you tell which side ones are the welded ones? You can if you look carefully, but yeah, I'm happy enough with that. That worked out way better. Like, there's all sorts of things that could have gone wrong making this, and so that worked out surprisingly well. So now, for making the basket guard type thing, which is very big, but you know, Warhammer proportions. I had a picture of the guard from the side, and that's what this line represents. There's like a golden colored plate here that has leaves, and then like a more plain plate here. I had a picture from the side, and I had a picture from the front that showed the edge of this golden plate. And this picture from the side presumably shows the edge of the top plate. And what I needed was this bit in between. And so I'd like to thank Caffeine Lich over on the Michael Cthulhu Discord, which I think is a Patreon, it's still a Patreon only thing. But he worked out this shape for me, the shape of the front of the thing. I only needed to fiddle with it a little bit to get it. But this other shape in here was very complicated. So what I did was put tape, just a bunch of that blue painter's tape, and then take the blue painter's tape off and then transfer that to a cardboard shape. And so that's how I got this shape. But this thing, I spent nearly a day messing around with this cardboard thing. Hang on, can I show the measurements? See, like, by creating the thing from the side, splitting it up into sections, I could get the heights, like, you know, mapping across to get, there's like a center line, and it's like, what distance are these things from the center line? And that's what all those numbers there are. And that's how much they come up. Each slice comes up by that amount. And that's how I got this thing. Yeah, no, I just felt, while I like messing around with bits of cardboard, it's kind of fun, and it's nice to do something that isn't burning me for a change. There's all sorts of other complicated things, like the, it starts up here in the center of the handle, but it winds up actually off-centered on the other end. All sorts of fun and games. But yeah, it kind of feels silly when you have to spend an entire day messing around with cardboard to get a shape. Yeah. This is watered down vinegar, so I'm not sure will it have. This piece in particular, it's kind of silly doing the vinegar on because I have to do so much forging and stuff on it. It's just the vinegar takes the scale off, which makes the abrasive softer on the abrasives, because I find the abrasives rip through stuff unevenly if the scale is not on certain parts of it, but it is on other parts of it. So the advantage of it being a nice sunny day is these will dry real quick, but if there's any moisture left on the surface, it'll turn into rust almost immediately. Kind of a dull overcast day is kind of the best for doing this. One where it's not literally raining outside. So this section of the basket guard thing, it's not real basket guard, but whatever, you can fight about it in the comments, has these leaf shapes, not leaf, bird leaves, feather shapes stamped into it. And so on the side view, which is harder to see, they're more like you'd expect, like little separate plates that are overlapping each other. But the artist has drawn them like little elongated hexagons that are interlocking over here. And this shape, I'm hopeful that we'll be able to stamp directly into this plate. So I want to do a sample piece and see, is this possible? And if this isn't possible, then I might have to get into making a whole bunch of different things and welding them on. But I hope I don't have to do that. So we're just going to see, is it possible to stamp this kind of pattern directly into a 1/8 inch plate? So this is a sample piece I made, just freehand with a marker, and then scanned in a thing, and then so I could get the other side. And I think, I'm not sure, but I think to get this properly, all the different ways it has to bend, like this bends in a few ways that would only be possible with very thin material. I think what's going to happen is I'm going to have to die grind out these, get these crinkles separately, because the crinkles are fine. Wait, are they fine? The crinkles are fine, but it's this zigzag across I'm worried about. So I think I'm going to do that with the die grinder. Too hot to touch. I dug a hole for sitting this guy upright, but I dug it too deep. I was kind of hoping this thing would be at a height I could work at, but I'm gonna have to sit in a chair when I'm using this thing. The extra depth means at least it won't fall over. Yeah, this will be, I might even have to get a lower chair. Ah. Okay, no, that works. I wish the middle one was bumped up more. I might do my trick where I score it on the back. Actually, that's kind of better to use a small chisel.
See, that's kind of crude, but that was the practice one. That's kind of what we're going for. And if we do that to the entire surface, let's see what happens.
Disaster! Yon camera fell off yon tripod and smashed onto the ground, breaking its lens. Good news! My camera has finally returned from the repair place. And it seems to be working, but let's stick this memory card from this camera in here and see is that actually the case.
So, this camera served me well while the other one was in the shop. The little flip-out screen, the feedback on it is much smoother. I'd forgotten how smooth. Autofocus. Let's see how long it takes, because this one had basically no autofocus. So if I go like this. Ha! Yeah. Go back here. And you go. Jerp! And then it goes, focus. You don't realize how much you missed that feature till it's gone. And the flip-out screen that flips around means it's easier now to film myself looking directly at you guys. So this guy, I'm relatively happy with how that came out, but I think this line could be sharper if it had a little help. So I'm going to grind out these lines and then hopefully that will make the bend a little bit more sharp. Now, to hit a bunch of stuff a bunch of times. So that's kind of the idea. You can see that gives it a bit of a texture. It catches the lights in certain ways. A couple of things I learned while doing this is I have to be careful not to let the chisel hop. Once this hopped once, I managed to keep it not hopping for the rest of it, so and hitting it from the behind, I have to be careful near the top of these, because the top of each one of these is thinner than the 1/8 inch plate. So I just have to be careful not to hit it with so much force. See, you can see there's a bad one here. See that little lump there? And that's just because that area is much thinner. I'm not exactly sure how you'd fix that, but I managed to avoid it for the other ones once I realized that was the thing that could happen. Whew! These ones are short enough to freehand, but I guess with these ones I have to get out my little ruler. But you know what? Before I go any further, A, B, 3, D, so that I don't mix them up.
Okay, is this thing all marked out? That was tedious.
This disc isn't round. I need to get a different disc. And it just broke too. Goddamn thing. Now, I want to actually score these lines on the front before I go hammering it from behind, because some of these lines were hard to get on the sample because of the material already being a bit curved and wibbly wobbly. So I'm going to do all these straights first on a flat surface. The little weird bouncy parts left a bunch of nicks that I might get out of the surface before shaping it from the other side, which is unfortunate. I tried to control it as best I could, but just if you had one of those super slow motion cams, you could show the pound and then the bounce and then this thing going skitter skitter. It's a particularly noticeable on this part. See all those little marks that went astray? I'm going to have to polish that again. Ugh. Now to clean it up a little bit. Ow. Ah. That's these angles roughly matching. If there's any mismatch left, I can get it with the heat and hammering such a treacher, but that's enough to start with, you know.
That wasn't so bad.
I drew this curve on here. So I'm gonna go and try to match it. Oh. Continuously having nightmares about curving it in the wrong direction. Where's the cardboard thing gone? I'm 99% sure it curves this way. There's the cardboard thing. Yeah. We're going this way. And once I start, I can't mess it up. What do I need the heat on this? It seems excessive. This long tail is bending easy peasy. But getting this part to bend. I almost wish I had a second thing. Oh boy. Might need to come up with something. Probably should have filmed some of that. I just welded a quick thing together. A mild steel half inch plate and then a piece of quarter inch plate. One nut and bolt. Big rock as a counterweight, and this is actually much easier to control and see what you're doing. A slow, very precise process, but that's fine by me. In the course of the bending, I lost about a quarter inch. I have to patch in a quarter inch piece here. Strangely enough, when I was bending the other one, and that's an even crazier shape, but it doesn't seem to have lost the length. It seems like it's a quarter inch longer than its neighbor. So I don't know what the hell happened. Now, the important thing, the reason we're doing this the awkward way. Remember, a lot of this comes off. We only want this piece. We don't want this piece. But the reason for doing it this way. Rocks a little bit, but it's mostly 90 degrees. Like if I push this up to make this 90 degrees, this tail levitates by just the tiniest little bit, but it's not twisted like a pretzel like I was worried about. Now I gotta weld the other side. So annoying. I wish I'd just cut this plate a bit longer. I went inside to print out the template again and make it just a little bit longer to cover this bit at the end, only to discover that the measurement of this guy around was the measurement the template had already. The mistake didn't happen at the stage where I was making the template. Somehow a piece of paper at the end of the template got nipped off, and that's why the piece of metal was short when I went to go cut it, which is very annoying. That's what I have to grind off now to make it perfectly correct. So this contraption here is to hold the angle correct while I aggressively muscle this guy into position. I'm not even sure it'll fully work, but my hope is it'll work enough for our purposes. So I'm gonna work down to heating up and bumping it along, getting it in position. So I've squished it in this guy, and it's touching here, but it's touching at a weird angle, so I'm only just going to give it a little tack. I wish this one was approaching it at the right angle. Here, can I get a good angle? So see that gap? This needs to go down. And this one, it's actually touching here, but the plate, get my fingernail here, so this feather, they're supposed to be feathers, is lower and this one is higher. If I tack it here, I might be able to, it might move by itself when I start heating things up and beating it into place. Ugh. My kind of hope is once I do the full weld, it'll all relax into something else, you know, because it'll be so friggin' hot. Where's the earth gone? This is the only thing about taking it, repositioning it so many times. Okay, that's that guy in position. I gotta do the full welds on this guy now. I welded both inside and outside, I think. See this edge? It's rubbing off my hand. Ah! And this thing's too long, it's rubbing off the camera. It would have been way easier to weld from this other side, but I have the support in here to try and keep it the correct curve, so I couldn't weld it from the other direction. The other part should be easy peasy to weld because it's, you know, on the outside or whatever. Wow, so hot, but that's those things joined together. Woo. Now, this side of the well to do. Here's my temple gun. I might redraw the line. So that's the outside join, the important one, the one everyone's going to see cleaned up. So can I keep this guy in focus as I go all along this join? I actually ground in a little bit extra. It's welded on the back, so the front one is just kind of for decoration and appearance. But I ground in a line that, like, by all rights doesn't really need to be there, so that there's a clear delineation between the two shell halves. These ones up here, where it takes this curve, there's a nice angle change. But yeah, there's some of them, like for this guy, that angle, the angle difference between this and this, they're nearly identical. So without that line, this would probably just be a plane. So yeah, that's why I ground in this line. that's probably good enough that we can move on to the next part. I'll clean up the ugly ass weld on the back where this guy was getting in the way of my wrists. Both wrists, both the torch and the electrode and the I'm tired. You know what I mean? Both the filler material and the torch. Well, I'll clean this one up just a little bit. It'd actually be, you could probably grind it flat without too much disaster. It's practically flat already, but I don't want it for strength because I did quite a lot of grinding on this front part of the shell. Feels smooth enough to me. I don't think anyone's going to cut their hands on that.
Abrupt cut to me standing here. If you're seeing this, it means I was worried the almighty algorithm would punish me for uploading a video over 4.5 hours long. Right at the end of this video, there should be a floating box on the screen with a link to a playlist of all the different parts of this build video. If not all of the parts of the build video are in the playlist, they'll be uploaded once a week till they are all there. Alternatively, you can see the whole 4.5 hours right now by heading over to my Patreon, a wonderful place where algorithms don't exist and I can upload whatever the hell I want. If for some reason YouTube has changed its thing yet again, and there's no box on the screen with a link to the playlist, I'll put a link to the playlist in the video description and as a comment underneath the video.